Hey everyone, this is Raptor Chatter here with the first part of the year in review that's organized by Edge every year among paleo YouTubers. With all that said, I'm going to be looking at some of the biggest finds from January, so let's get started. To get started, we're going to be looking at something that could be very important for future research, and that's the first potential fossils of choanoflagellates, which are actually really closely related to Metazoa, which is animals, just period and end. All animals are metazoans, meaning this is potentially our sister group, and again, the first fossils of them that we've ever found. Choanoflagellates are called this because they have a flagellum. It's this long tail kind of thing that they flop around and are able to move through the water with that. And oftentimes they're also colonial and will live together. These fossils that are found using scanning electron microscopes were actually shown to have potentially the flagellum and some of the connective tissues that would have connected the different cells of the colony. With these being the first fossils from choanoflagellates, it does mean at least hopefully we can start using some of these methods to look for them elsewhere and potentially really understand when choanoflagellates started to evolve, because that would also mean potentially the evolution of animals as a whole. Jumping into more famous paleontological discussions though, we also had a paper that was saying, hey, Tyrannosaurus could have been as smart or at least had as many neurons as a baboon, which would have been a lot. Now this paper was criticized at the time because it was written by a neuroscientist, not a paleontologist, meaning that there are some gaps in the differences of what they're specialized in. And yes, they are very smart at looking at brains, but fossils are a lot harder to try and make these inferences from. And so while it is a really interesting study, I think we're going to need a little bit more work before we really understand how much this is the case and what kind of intelligence animals like Tyrannosaurus rex had. I also have an entire video on that if you're interested, but that's a much longer story. Finish this first. Looking at other dinosaurs, we're going to be actually looking at a very early bird, Cratonavis zhui, which is really interesting because when we look at its skull isn't actually that bird-like. And that's because it's a largely akinetic skull, meaning the bones don't really move relative to one another that much. Meanwhile, when you look at modern birds, especially things like parrots, you can see they have a very kinetic skull. The bones do move a whole lot relative to one another. In general, most dinosaurs had akinetic skulls, and it's just the birds that really changed this. This fossil is interesting, though, because it still has a lot of other bird-like features, such as a pygostyle, which would have let it make a fan of feathers at the end of its tail, as opposed to having a deep V in it like we expect to find in many kinds of dromaeosaurs. This means that the evolution of bird skulls is actually totally separate from their ability to fly, because from what we know of Cratonavis, it definitely could fly. Its hands were built for flight, they were built and looked like modern bird wings, at least mostly. This means that this isn't something we can just go, oh cool, they evolved this all and their specialized skulls just because of flight. No, it was a later pressure that actually really led to this kind of adaptation, and hopefully with more fossils we'll be able to understand better how bird skulls actually took their shape. Speaking of the hands of dinosaurs, we're going to be jumping into the Megaraptorans, which are one of the worst known groups of dinosaurs, but had very large hands, and it's suggested that this was probably for capturing prey, and potentially they didn't have as large and bulky of heads as many other theropods, especially large theropods like the tyrannosaurs or the giganotosaurs. However, this paper was actually looking at the musculature in those hands to see how good they would have been at actually catching something. The researchers mapped out where different muscles would have attached based on the arm fossils we do have of many different Megaraptorans, and you can see that with the different muscles being labeled in this image. These muscles aren't really that different from any other theropod's arms though, they're just larger. This suggests that it was already built in for theropods to have these kinds of grappling hands, and the Megaraptorans just took it to an extra extreme. That's especially true when you look at not necessarily the muscles, but the tendons, where potentially they had a greater ability to flex their hands and move them in different directions when wrangling prey. And apparently that is what those big meaty claws were used for. Despite their name, Megaraptorans aren't actually that closely related to the raptor dinosaurs or the dromaeosaurs. However, they also had very similar adaptations, except in raptor dinosaurs, it was on the feet with their large sickle claws. And a paper also looked at modern-day birds to try and understand how they might have used those claws. And that's because the red-legged Seriema actually was able to use its claws to hold down prey and then be able to dispatch it using its beak, or potentially by slamming it into the ground the way modern-day Seriemas do, which is very intensive. This suggests that, unlike Jurassic Park, where they talk about, oh, you know, this claw is used to cut animals open, it's really not that likely that that's what it was for. Instead, it's more likely that it aligns with the raptor prey restraint hypothesis, which is essentially that, no, this claw is there so that it could use its feet to control its prey, and then again, dispatch it using its head. It's not necessarily this big, dramatic slicing weapon the way that Jurassic Park suggests. Staying with archosaurs, but this time jumping to the pterosaurs, there's a new tenochasmatid named, and it's been called Balaenognathus maeuseri. And it's actually really interesting because it seems like it was very, very well adapted to filter feeding. There's a few other pterosaurs that have been suggested to have been filter feeders. However, this one has taken that to a very large extreme, and potentially was actually able to just sit in a current and filter feed very small crustaceans or other plankton that would have been flowing along the current. And then it could essentially scoop that up, push out the water, and eat what was left. What I may think be a different alternative to this very passive hypothesis, though, is that it could have potentially been feeding more like a roseate spoonbill, which is much more active and walking around the water while it feeds. But we see this kind of thing in large birds today. It makes sense that pterosaurs could have filled a similar niche millions of years ago. On the subject of movement, we can look at the first archosaur, or at least the earliest known diverging archosaur, and that's Euparkeria. Euparkeria is known as the first archosaur because it's the first fossil that we've really found that had its legs straight down below its body, as opposed to sprawling out more like a lizard. It's even been suggested that Euparkeria could have ran on just two legs, but that hasn't really been quantitatively tested until this paper came out. And with all their math and many graphs showing the different ranges of motion in the different limbs, it seems like Euparkeria was actually probably quadrupedal and couldn't really run on two legs. Still though, that action and evolution of moving up and off the ground to facilitate a different type of movement served the archosaurs well, as the dinosaurs and the crocodilians would both evolve from this group. But there were other organisms also evolving around the Triassic, and some of them we still have today, including the caecilians, or gymnophonia. These are weird amphibians that mostly live underground and are kind of tube-like. Often they don't even have limbs, and sometimes they produce a mucus that their young eat. They're a weird group. But now we have the earliest known fossil of one coming from the Triassic of the Petrified Forest National Park. Funcusvermis gilmorei is known from microfossil sites, and what that means is they took a whole bunch of mud from the park, sifted it through many different sizes of strainers, and then were able to look at that under a microscope and go, hey, that looks like a bone, hey, that looks like another piece of a bone, that looks like another piece of a bone, and then very carefully glue those together so that you can see what kind of bone it would have been. And it does align with the caecilians. This is really interesting, and it actually does support some differences in what we potentially thought about their evolution, because amphibian evolution is really hard to know. We have very large amphibians in the fossil record, or at least amphibian relatives, like the temnospondyls, and then suddenly we just get almost modern amphibians. That includes frogs and salamanders, and some caecilians. Because of some of the traits that are present on Funcusvermis' jawbones, it really does suggest that they actually came from one specific group of the temnospondyls, the dicerophoids, and that from the dicerophoids, all modern-day amphibian groups, the caecilians, the amphibians, and the frogs, all evolved from. It's not like there was some separate group that was more ancestral in their evolution that the caecilians split off from, and they just happened to persist in the modern day. It's also really important for understanding where caecilians are today, because they basically live along the equator, and at this time, in Arizona, that would have been the equator. So it seems like they evolved there and then basically stayed there. As for strange animals from slightly earlier, we have the Iniopterygids, which are very strange chimera relatives, which means they're related to sharks, but not sharks. Think of things like the ratfish as an example of a modern day one. However, this study was looking at their jaws to see how they likely fed. What they found is high-performance suction feeding. And by that it means essentially the way frogfish do today. They sit on the bottom and potentially just open their mouth very quickly, and that draws in a lot of water and the prey. Now, it's really hard to say for sure if the Iniopterygids actually sat along the bottom. However, their very, very strange fins, I think at least, do suggest that it would have been possible for them to do that. And then, potentially, they were just filling that niche along different reef systems. And unfortunately, the Permian-Triassic extinction came and they went extinct because they are wild animals. I would have loved to see what one looked like in real life. Speaking of fossils, before the Permian-Triassic extinction, there is also a look at insect fossils, and this is really important because the Permian-Triassic extinction is the only mass extinction that significantly affected what kind of insects were around. And I was essentially just trying to go, hey, what kinds of groups of insects were around beforehand and afterwards? Genetic data has been able to show certain divergent times for different groups of insects. One such example is the wasps, which it's suggested diverged from the other insects back before the Permian-Triassic extinction. The question is just, were they actually wasps then, or were they just the precursors to wasps? And what the paper finds is probably not. And this tracks with a lot of groups. Essentially, the crown group didn't exist yet, but they had diverged from their relatives. When I say crown group, it's essentially the first ancestor with all of the traits we would associate with that later group, or essentially the modern animals that are related to it. What this means is the Paleozoic insect fossil record is still very important for understanding their modern diversity. However, when we want to understand the evolution towards modern day types of insects, we need to look after the Permian-Triassic extinction, especially with the start of things like angiosperms much later during the Cretaceous, where suddenly they burst into life and that opened up a lot of ecospace for different animals. And on the subject of arthropods, there was also a paper that looked at Walliserops, which is a strange genus of trilobites with long tridents at their front, and it's been suggested these could have been used for many different things, including potentially foraging. However, one was found to have had a damaged trident. It actually turned into a fork, and a very poorly built fork at that. With the poorly built fork of this one individual of Walliserops, it really suggests it wasn't used for feeding, because this thing was almost fully grown. It wasn't necessarily slowed down that much just because of a damaged trident. This makes it much more likely that this trident was actually being used for competition within its own species. Essentially, hey, we want to try and win over mates, we're going to fight about it. There's also some other fossils of other trilobites from the same area that could represent the other sex of the trilobites, but it's really hard to know that for sure. And finally, in human evolution, it's kind of a crapshoot sometimes. And by that I mean a lot of times when we look at our phylogenies, they don't line up the same way. Or sometimes there's the same genus that is actually placed on many different lines that aren't very close to one another and with other species in between. It means there needs to be a lot of revision of taxonomy for hominin evolution. And you'll hear more about some of this from Will later in one of the other months in reviews. However, this paper essentially went, hey, look, we've reanalyzed Australopithecus, and it actually does line up somewhat closer to some of the other hypotheses. Again, there's going to be a lot of work to try and get hominin evolution better understood. The taxonomy is just, it's terrible. However, this is a good step to start working on that, and hopefully we'll see some more progress on this further in the future. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. If you are new to the channel, be sure to check out our other videos. We kind of do this every month, where we look at a lot of the papers, and especially some of the more niche papers that you may not have heard about. Also, if that interests you and you want to support the channel, be sure to check out our Patreon or our Discord, where you can have conversations with me and other people who are interested in paleontology. Be safe, take care, don't go extinct.